yourself.
Okay.
Okay, do that.
Okay. Hi, I'm Larry Howe. I'm the old owner now of this house, and be glad to give you the tour. So let's start in the dining room.
Okay.
This is a very unique table arrangement, but it's actually never been used by us. But it has a feature where if you want to make the table larger, all you do is pull this out, and then underneath it are the leaves that you fold out to make it larger. And when you don't need them anymore, you fold them back down in, push this back, and it's back to its original size.
Perfect.
Okay.
Oh, I didn't want to do that one.
Okay. All right, let's start back here. Now, you ready?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. In here, you will need to realize that this switch has to stay on all the time because it controls the fan and the light. But now it's controlled with remote control. So when you want to turn on the light and the fan, don't touch the switch, but go to the remote control. And the top one is blue, which controls the fan. And it has different speeds. All you got to do is keep touching it, and it goes down. Goes down another notch, and then finally you touch it.
Can you get the light on?
And it goes off.
Because everything is just okay. Really, really dark.
And then to turn the light on,
there you go.
You press the yellow button, and it's actually dims if you wanted to some degree, or you can cut it directly off. So remember, leave that switch on all the time. But control both the fan and the light with the remote control. It's self-explanatory, although when you raise them, just like you would any other shade, and then pull them back down with the chain. But the unique thing about these that bears mentioning is you can see out, but someone else cannot see in. So they're custom made for that reason. So, if you want them all up, they will tell you that I leave them down most of the time because of the bright sunlight coming in will have a tendency to fade your floor covering if you do not leave them down most of the time. But that's up to you as whether or not you want them up or down.
Okay.
From the Army Corps of Engineers that you probably should read, because the Army Corps controls the lake and they can take it up, take it down, or do anything they want to it. Because it's fully controlled by them. Okay, on the stove top, the one thing I would want to point out is this particular eye section has a full replacement. This one is worn somewhat, as you can tell, over the years from use, but the replacement is in this box, this styrofoam box. You pull it out, you take this one out by lifting it up and pulling it out like this. And then you'll insert the other one in its place if you want to. Or you can take the grill out on this side and have them both stovetops by putting that one here in its place. It has a downdraft fan. So when you want to turn the fan on, you turn it on and it pulls the smoke downward and then out of vent that goes outside. Rather than having a vent above, we chose to have a downdraft vent. We never had a trash compactor. This is it. You do not see those in most houses anymore. We have always had one in every house we've had, just about. But it's fully functional. It is the original one. It's still good, as far as I know. It runs well. The dishwasher runs well. Everything in here functions properly. And that refrigerator is fairly new. The laundry room has two switches. One controls the light in the laundry room, the first one. The second one controls the light in the pantry. And so the pantry, of course, I will have cleaned out, but the pantry has adequate shelving that you put a lot of things in there. And it has a pocket door, which you simply pull out and you can shut it off if you don't want to use it. And I leave it open most of the time, just your preference. It has a vent here for the air conditioning for this old area. We have already seen it has all Anderson windows and doors throughout the house. These in particular on this floor only are casement windows, or some people call them jalousy windows. But in order to get them open and closed, it has two switches or flips here. You flip them up when you want to roll them out, and then you roll them back in, lock them down, pull these back down to close them. They're here, they're over on beside the French doors, and they're in the kitchen. And that's all there is in the entire house as far as casement type windows.
We're starting over.
Okay.
Go.
Doors are locked. In order to open them, turn the knob, which pushes out the pull down on them to open them, like that. Same, this one, same way, pull down on it to open it. To lock them, push it back, pull up to lock this one, take this back, pull up, lock this one, turn the deadbolt.
Okay.
The only thing I want to point out about the deck is it has a pergola over top of it that has a lattice work, and you won't believe how much sun this deflects, even though it has holes in it. It will deflect a lot of sun, and it'll be a lot cooler as a result. It's amazing how much it can deflect the sun.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Don't make any difference. Just okay. Talk to me.
Okay. Thing about the pool is this is a salt system swimming pool. I don't know if you're familiar with them or not, but they are very easy to maintain. It has an automatic robot. It is on a timer. It is a cleaner, and I typically run it anywhere from an hour and a half to 2 hours a day only. That's all you'll have to run it. It'll climb the walls, find the steps, and do a great job. When you want to clean it, you'll have to pull it out, make sure it's not running while you're doing that, because it's on a separate motor. So when it's not running and you want to clean the bag out, pull it over to the side, pull it up out of the water, and then this little hook and reach down and pull it to you with this. Pull it all the way to you, and then you'll see when you pull it up, it has a bag on it. All you gotta do is pinch the sides off where it fits into the robot. Pull it up, it has a clip on the back that holds the bag to the hose. Take the clip off, and thus the whole bag will come off. It has Velcro top that seals it, so open up the Velcro bag, empty it out. I would recommend that you rinse it out, either with a hose or a bucket or some other means, and then put it back like you brought it out, and then make sure it's on in straight position, throw it back in the water, and you're done. This is the long pole that's telescopic that you put on the ends of it whether you want to skim the water, the surface of the water, or you want to brush the pole. And so I keep it back here behind here, kind of out of sight, but it's waterproof, so don't worry about being out in the weather. And this is originally a trash can, but I utilized it for a place to hold the brush that you can attach to the end of this pole. It has little slots in here that spring loaded that'll snap in. That's the brush. Here is the top skimmer to skim things off the top. When you open up the two skimmers, which are one on each side, one there, one across over there, and you pull them up, I can demonstrate how we do that. When you pull them up, be careful not to use your hands. Use that hook, because you can critter might come up with you. But it's stuck because of the weather.
Yep.
And cut it off. You can actually drain it in the winter if you don't want to use it. I'll show you how to do that.
Okay.
One more thing. Up here. This ladder looks funny, but it's designed this way because to keep the robot from getting hung up on the ladder if it was down all the time, this is suspended when the robot runs around. And when you want to swim, you can actually pull this off, take it completely off, or you can take out the pins on each side, lower it down in through there, and use it as a step ladder.
Okay.
This is another neat feature that goes really with the protection that's on the side rails of that ladder. This actually zips on and off. And because the ultraviolet rays is so hard on this during this hot summer, then you, in the wintertime, I always unzip them, take them off, and I take the ladder completely inside and store it in the room downstairs in the basement. In order to put it back on, however, you have to wet it first, put it down in the water and wet it, because that allows you to stretch it. So you start at either end, but it has, it's just like a regular zipper. It zips all the way on and zips all the way off. So I recommend you take it in during the winter, put it back when it gets hot enough, because to the touch, this thing's extremely hot if you didn't have this to touch your hand. Now, to backwash the pool in the spring, you'll have to do it more often because pollen will collect in there quickly. You just heard the other motor cut on, and that's for the robot. In order to backwash, you have to turn the left-hand motor off. Both motors have to be off. Then you have to close all these valves, which means they turn this way. All of them turn, and there's one here. One, two, three, four valves.
One,
turn off.
Two, three, and four.
And four. Once you do, make sure it's still off. You have to clean out this filter, and you simply undo these, unscrew them, they fall down. You take the top off, there is a basket in there that you will remove that has collected debris, and then just toss it over there, clean it out, put it back in there, put the top back on, pull these back up, tighten them down tightly, and then when you want to backwash, then turn these back on to their on position. And then you take this handle and pull it around to where it says backwash. Then you turn the left-hand motor on, and you can see now down here is a tube.
Oh, state that again.
All right. Down here beyond these rocks right here, you can see the tip of it, is a white tube. That
yes.
Is the water will flow out of that tube, and when it's backwashed, it'll be yellow looking, but you have to run it for probably, I don't know, 5 minutes or so until it starts to clear up. Then you stop it by going over and stopping the motor. Then to rinse it, you then take this and pull down on it and turn it from backwash all the way back to where it says rinse. And then when it says rinse, which is back over here, right here, then you will do the same thing. You'll turn the motor back on. It will flow out that same tube. And it will not have to run near as long as the backwash because it doesn't take very long to rinse it because the water will be pretty clear from the get-go. So then when you do that, you cut the motor back off. And then when you want to take it back to where it originally was, you put it back on filter. You'll see it back here, it says filter. So keep it on that position while it's running from then on. So that's all you do to backwash, rinse, and then put it back to the original position. One more thing, here is a valve that controls that waterfall. If you want to turn it off.
Which one would you touch it?
Yeah, this one. This controls the waterfall. If you want to turn it off, like if you want to turn it off in the winter, then you
just flip that.
You simply move it all the way down to the left. If you want to drain the pipes that go to the waterfall to make sure they don't freeze, you turn this faucet on until it quits running, and it will drain all the pipes. When it quits draining, you turn it back to the shut position.
Okay.
Okay. And then, as long as you leave it over there, it will be off. If you want to turn it back on again, then you simply put it to the upright position, and then it will come back on when you turn the motor on. One thing about the pool, it does require things other than salt. Salt's a 40-pound bag of granular pool salt that you can get at Walmart, Lowe's, or any other place like that. And you add it, and there is a panel over there. I should have shown you. All right. This is the electronic panel that controls your readings for the salt level, acidity, pH, and all the other things that go into a pool. Right now, the meter shows that it's on 2900. That is the level of the salt. You want the salt to be between 2500 at the low point and no more than 3500 at the high point. So anywhere between 2500 and 3500 is good. I prefer to keep it right around 29 to 3000 all the time. You see a light flashing there, which indicates that it's inspect the sail. The sail is this thing right over here. This is what produces, takes the salt and produces chlorine, to have chlorine in your pool. Periodically, when that light is on, is an indication that it either needs to be checked or cleaned. Most of the time, it'll come on with power surges and things like that. But most of the time, you won't even have to worry with it. And to make sure that you cut off the light, all you gotta do is turn this down, back up to the top, and back this position, and it'll eventually go off. If it doesn't, then all you gotta do is put that, keep pressing this button, which goes through the various readings on the pool, and this will show you everything. I've got a book up inside. Inside I'll show you. And see, it's back to the 2500, and the light went out.
Okay.
So you go back to the middle position.
Okay.
One of the things about the pool, too, you'll have to do periodically is refill it with water. After you backwash and rinse, it lowers the level of the pool, obviously. So then to backfill the pool, you have to take a regular hose and connect it to, there is a faucet at the bottom of those steps coming down to the gate that you can tap into and then run your hose up and then refill the pool. And you refill the pool from the meter, the second meter, on which you do not have to pay sewer. Don't use the regular house water for that, because you have to pay sewer on that if you do. So always use the second meter for refilling the pool, or if you want to pressure wash your driveway, or you want to wash your vent, whatever else you want to do that requires a lot of water, always use the second meter for that. Okay. Here's the boat. I have it covered for the winter. I didn't choose to unwrap it yet because of just all the pollen, spider webs, and all that. When you take the cover off, there is a rack over here that I put on the two uprights. And there is a PVC pipe structure that goes all the way across and down, and it fits into two slots that you'll see when you uncover it. Take that off and hang it up on those two hangers for the winter, for the summer. You won't need it again until you're gonna lock it down for the next winter. And then you put the cover back on. You can take the cover up and put it in the workshop in the basement. I have it bungeed on. It has ropes all the way around it. But when you take it off, you will already can see that there'll be a lot of spiders, webs. There'll be a lot of mud daubers, nests that you will have to clean off, and then clean the upholstery. And then there is a automatic charger for the battery underneath one of these seats. All the seats, the long bench seats, lift up, and there's storage underneath all of them. And in one of them, I forget which one I put it in, but in it you'll find an automatic charger. At the very back, there is a long bench seat that you'll pull up, and underneath that is the battery compartment. I took some of the terminals off for the winter. And so you'll have to put the terminals back on. You'll be able to read positive and negative. And then you'll take the charger and which has two clips, one for positive, one for negative. It has an electrical outlet here you can plug it into and then charge the battery, and because it's automatic, it will charge it to its full charge, and a green light will come on when it's fully charged. Then you'll know it's ready to be cranked. Come over here. This is how you crank it for the first time, especially. Right here is a captain's seat for the steering wheel that just, it swivels. Here's the controls. Here is the throttle. So when you crank it for the first time, you like to pull the throttle up about halfway. Here is the key I will leave in the basement drawer in a cabinet. I'll point out later. So you put the key in this slot. In order to choke it, you have to push the key in and crank it. Well, because it's been sitting all winter, it will not crank the first time. It will attempt to crank, and you may have to do it several times before it finally catches and runs continuously. But this controls the speed, which is in neutral. This controls the speed once it starts running. This is the idle speed all the way down. This controls the further you push this up, the faster it will go. So you just have to play with it until you get it running like you want it, and then put it back in idle position before you attempt to take it out. The motor is up because of the winter. To put it down on this control here, you press down on that button, and that lowers the motor all the way into the water. Conversely, if you want it up, you push the top button, it pulls it up. And when you need to change oil or add oil, you will see in the top of the motor, it's a 75 horse Mercury motor, outboard, you will see a big round cover that you screw off, and that's where the oil filler is for the two-stroke engine. There is oil underneath the metal compartment here. There's also oil, I think, in one of the cabinets in the basement. So you'll have plenty of oil, and it has a oil pump that pumps the oil and mixes it with the gas. One of the things about the gas I would recommend you do at least once a year is go to auto parts up here called
AutoQuest,
and they sell something called Seafoam. Take a can of that, pour it into the gas tank, and it displaces any water that's in the gas, and it makes your engine run better. You can use it in your lawnmower, or anything else you want to use it in, but it's great stuff. It's called Seafoam. One more feature of the boat that you'll like. It has an aluminum deck. Very few boats, pontoons, have aluminum decks, which means it will not rot, decay, or rust. Most of them have marine plywood. That one has aluminum. That's why we bought it. It's made in Alma, Michigan, and it's about one of the only few in the country that put aluminum decks on. One of the things you'll know that it has a three-way switch, which means this switch to the far right, that switch turns the lights on. If you want to go out this door, then this switch will cut it off, and vice versa. So it's a three-way switch. I just replaced them. They're new. They work great. Okay, in here you'll find a lot of things, some of which I will leave for you, some of which my son is coming to get over the weekend. But one of the things that involves the boat that you'll want to know is that here is the depth finder that you'll see on the console where the steering wheel is. You put it down on there, turn on the power button, it'll show you the depth, and has other features. It has a menu that you can scroll through and go from there. In here is two sets of keys for the boat, and they got floats in case you drop them in the water. And in it is also is your registration, which you will have to get periodically. I think this one's good for, I don't know, it has the stickers down there on the boat, but it's good for more than 1 year. Yeah, it's good until May 2020. Okay, so you won't have to get another one until then.
Okay.
And you'll get it in the mail when it's time to renew it. and a fee, of course, that goes with it. So I'll leave this in the drawer. Other things I will take out, but this will be left in the drawer right there for you. And some other things I will take. That's your depth finder. I'll put it right behind it. And then back here is a lot of this equipment my son will take. But here's some floats for the pool. Hardly ever been used. And that's the solar blanket for the pool that's cut into the irregular shape of the pool, if you ever want to use it. It's good in the winter time for not only the warmth, but also to protect it from leaves, which there will be very few leaves. You'll find most of it's pine needles because I cut down all the trees around it some time ago to keep them from falling in the pool. It has these are floats also that I'm leaving. These are things that you can sit on the side of the pool where it's real hot and it won't burn you. In that box is some spare parts for the robot in case you run into problems. You can use the spare parts from that. That's the old one. That's only the second we've had, and the pool was put in 2001. So it's a gunite pool. It is in great shape, so you won't have to worry about that. That is the central vacuum system. You'll see upstairs all the outlets. There's outlets in every room in the house, including the basement. Not one in here, but one on the other side. All the finished parts have outlets for the plug-in vacuum. It has that umbrella I'm taking with me, that is for the beach. And back here, underneath all this stuff, you will find, sorry about the mess, but you will find back here in this two boxes are inserts from the table that's up on the second tier patio. And you'll notice that it's a round table, and in the middle of it, the metal part comes out, and it has two things. They're both copper. They're copper inserts that you can put down in it. And in the wintertime, you can use it as a fire pit because it also has a screen that goes over top of it. In the summer, it has a separate copper insert that will go in there, and you can put ice in it and put cold drinks in.
Okay.
You're wondering where the panels are for the electricity. They're behind these closed doors. Except in the very top upstairs where all the bedrooms are, in the storage room behind that bedroom, is a panel for just the breakers up there. Down here, there are two. And they're labeled, they're behind here. They're kind of camouflaged, but they're labeled for whatever you will see. They're all labeled as to what they go to. So some of them are 20 amp, some are 15 amp, and some are even more, 30 amp. So it depends on how much power they need. And over here is the rest of them for all that you will need. And they're labeled also.
Start over on pool table.
Pardon?
Start over on pool table.
On the pool table, it's a tournament regulation length and width, 9 feet by 4.5, which is what is tournament pool. And that's made in Macon, Georgia. And it came from a place in Greenwood, South Carolina called Buck Stove and Pool, which you'll also want to go to for your pool needs. The stained glass light has a control right there. The rest of the lights are controlled either there or there. One's over there, one's over here. And then the light over the pool table is a separate switch. The air handling room for the main heat pump. And that's, both heat pumps are fairly new, within three to four years old. Both of them shouldn't have any trouble with them. I left you a contact for maintenance and service. It's also a storage room if you need it. So that's for the main heat pump.
This.
Okay. This is an electronic dartboard. Okay, you plug it in. There's a receptacle right there. You plug it in. It lights up. It'll show you how to use it. It has darts. I have more in the storage room in this closet here. And it keeps score automatically, and you'll love it. Don't know if you're familiar with this or not. This is a table shuffleboard, and a lot of people have them. This is more or less a miniature version of it, but this is a lot of fun also. And here is the hot water heater for the main two floors, the basement and the main floor. It is fairly new. It's probably only 3 or 4 years old. And one of the unique features about this is, you'll see coming out of the bottom, it has what you call a gate valve. And it has a piece of plastic called PEX that if you fill of it, it's warm all the time, which means it's a hot water recirculating line. It goes to the furthest point across the suspended ceiling into that workroom and goes to the furthest point away from the water heater, which is the kitchen sink. My wife has always complained about not having hot water quickly, so you'll find this is invaluable because when you turn it on, you'll have hot water instantly. And it doesn't have to have a pump, no electricity. It works on a gate valve principle, and it has to be insulated. It's insulated all the way through a loop that goes above the ceilings. You'll find you'll really love that. Also, in here, under this quilt, is a coffee table that matches the two end tables in the great room. If you want to use it, we chose to take it out and use a round one, but this is a rectangular one that matches the end tables in the great room, if you want to use it. This behind, this is a whole house water filter. And this, you have to change the insert or the cartridge periodically. You can get them at Lowe's or any hardware. They're made by 3M. That was originally made by Whirlpool. They quit making them, so 3M makes them now. So all you gotta do is, this part, you turn it to cut off the water. You take this and turn it counterclockwise to get it off. Change the filter. Put it back on, turn it clockwise to tighten it, hand tight only, turn it back on up here. These two things are the inside cutoffs for the water. You turn both of these off right here, pull them down like this, and it cuts them off. This one cuts the hot water off if you ever need to do that. So these are the in-house cutoffs, and also there's outside cutoffs at the meter, and I'll show you that in a minute, because you'll want to cut those off if you go off for any period of time. Thing in here, in this box right here, is an extra sink for the kitchen. It's never been used. They gave it to me free of charge as a backup in case there was ever a problem with the sink. It's a company called Elke. Wonderful to work with. These they also gave me, no charge, are inserts that you can put inside the sink. They're guards to help guard, they're like racks that help guard the sink surface. There's also a cleaner underneath the sink up there that you spray on periodically and then wipe it on, that helps keep it looking nice. The extras for your pool table and the dartboard are in that container on top of that box.